Hi, and thanks for tuning in to the endpointsecurity.ca podcast from Positive eSolutions. I'm Robbie Ferguson, and throughout the course of this podcast, combined with our blog, we want to provide you with a free resource to be able to educate yourself and your staff about the cybersecurity issues that are affecting you and your company in 2019. Over the years, the relationship between IT, cybersecurity, and the executive C-suite has changed. But as the perpetual slate of data breaches and hacking incidents shows, there's still a long way to go before they find themselves truly on the same page. Senior executives naturally have a lot on their plate, and IT has typically been one of the many silos in an organization that supports specific areas of a company's existence. In their case, it has everything to do with data. So, is it really necessary for the CEO of an organization to become hands-on with the concerns of IT? Jim Chalmers, Channel Chief at ESET Canada, believes so. In a recent email correspondence with Jim, he shared that while generally, in the past, cybersecurity was seen by the executives as a technology issue, thanks to legislation around mandatory disclosure of breaches and the media exposure of cybersecurity issues, it now goes far beyond technology. He pointed out that IT issues now have extended PR and brand implications, which are directly related to stock value, consumer confidence, and legal liability. This means that cybersecurity is really a corporate issue. To expand upon this, it's my pleasure to, in fact, welcome Jim to our virtual space. How are you, Jim?
I'm good, Robbie. Thanks for having me on today.
I want to get right into it. First of all, in your opinion, how have members of a company's executive leadership changed in terms of their understanding of cybersecurity in general? I mean, are they more in touch beyond simply knowing that it's important?
It's a great question. I think they've had to become more aware. I mean, years past, the security team was just a subset of a group of guys working three floors down in IT. But as we've seen, as you mentioned, the legislation come to pass, and as you've seen more cybersecurity in the news, you can't talk about that without talking about the issues in the U.S. with Russia hacking the DNC, etc. Right? CEOs have had to become extremely aware. As you said, it's no longer just a technology issue; it's a business issue. You know, we've seen companies that have been completely decimated because of a hack, not just a few days being down, but companies that have never recovered. So CEOs have had to be more involved in the security piece. They've had to, you know, kind of invite the security or the CSO from the kids table to the boardroom table to join the big table. It has to be a conversation in any business aspect going forward. So we've seen CSOs attend events where we've always had trouble getting CSOs to come out, right? But they're coming out in droves now.
Oh, great. Jim, I've got lots of questions for you, but for the sake of our listeners, a quick bit of history would probably help to put things into context. So looking at last year's Marriott breach, it was one of the most widespread so far, with 500 million accounts affected. And some experts have been pointing to unauthorized access to a database that was tied to customer reservations stretching from 2014 all the way through to September 10th, 2018. And it's a problem that was compounded by the fact that Starwood was being acquired by Marriott at the time, and Starwood's voluntary disclosure of the breach tended to get caught up in the transfer of assets. So this points to a clash of worlds, the executive strategy, cybersecurity, corporate mergers. Jim, is it enough for senior executives to leave the details to departmental managers, or should they themselves and their executive knowledge of cybersecurity, should that be more thorough?
Absolutely. I think that the Starwood-Marriott merger acquisition is a perfect example, right? It's no longer enough to look at, you know, do the brands come together properly? Is the stock value okay? And you now, the C-level executives have to have a knowledge of cybersecurity, because it's taking on a whole new life, right? Yeah. When you look at mergers and acquisitions now, they have to look at the security posture of the other company as well, right? They can't leave that to some, like I said, somebody three levels down. They have to, it's now a factor in kind of every business decision. Do we acquire that company? We take on their risk, right? How are we going to be viewed if we have to disclose this breach from a company that we purchased 2 years ago,
Wow.
That's the kind of thing that has to happen.
Yeah, it's like
the Starwoods one was a fantastic example, right? I don't think Marriott actually knew that. I don't think they looked that deep into the security posture of the Starwoods hotel chain before they purchased it. And they're going to pay that price.
So is that wising up executives to realize that, okay, just like when we're making this big purchase, we need to look at the past debts of these companies. Now, exactly. are we looking at cybersecurity as, you know, to that extent of, you know, we're auditing the company before we make the purchase?
Yeah, I mean, the audit now goes deeper than just stock value, or, you know, like do the brands come together? Not even their security posture they currently have. Did they have a breach 2-3 years ago? Did they have to disclose that?
Yeah.
You know, when they start looking at the PR piece, PR is no longer were the sheets clean or did I get a good reservation? It is, was my information shared online? Did I get that letter from the company saying that you might have been breached or your information? That is all part and parcel of these mergers and acquisitions and everyday business for the C-level executives now. If they don't, they're going to be in trouble going forward. That's what it boils down to.
Sure. So as company executives now, looking to the future, like, we've got to be very, very focused on the cybersecurity issue for the future.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, I don't think it's enough to even have a CIO. I think you need to have a CSO. You need to have a C-level security officer in any company of any significance at this point. And if not, they need to outsource some of that to a company that does, right? It's no longer enough to call this a technology issue. It's a business issue.
It makes such a difference to the IT department as well, who maybe has not been entirely focused on the cybersecurity threats because, hey, we're all busy, right? We've got computers to fix and printers that aren't working and networks that need building and everything else.
You talk to any IT guy, you know, works in a large corporation, and they're always asked to do more with less, right?
Yeah.
We always see,
it comes down to time too. Like, do more with less time. I'm going to take some of your time.
Right.
Yeah.
But then it's always interesting. I was going to say funny, but it's certainly not funny. Yeah. It's always interesting when you see what happens after a company's been breached. All of a sudden, their budget for security skyrockets. The IT department all of a sudden has more budget and more time. And what I think needs to happen, and what we're seeing more and more now, is C-level executives are actually trying to get ahead of that.
Yeah.
And they have to, right? You can pay now or you can pay significantly more later. You can pay now with budget and time and resources, or you can pay later with budget, time, resources, and damage to your brand, damage to your customers, damage to the company.
It's always the case. It's better to pay out to be proactive than to have to pay out to be reactive. Absolutely.
It's still an interesting conversation because they said you would expect with all of the cybersecurity breaches and just the awareness that you see more and more executives going to that. It's still very much a slow burn.
Yeah. Jim, since it might be unfair to place all the blame on executives, what should cybersecurity specialists themselves do to, or what can we do to be, to help me as a cybersecurity person to understand how I can influence and even manage up to the executives? Because, like, this is the problem. The whole silo mentality of the past has led us to, you know, we're basically separated or segregated from the various departments. So, you know, I start to wonder about that silo mentality. Is that a good thing at this point, or is this something that needs to be changed?
Well, first off, you know, changing the conversation, you talk about cybersecurity specialists, you know, we kind of live and breathe this stuff. So we have our own kind of a vernacular that we use, et cetera. You know, we have to change the conversation from technology, products, even solutions, to talking about risk. C-level executives, they don't necessarily care about the technology that's used or even talk in terms of cybersecurity. They talk about mitigating risk. Now, the reality is everybody's going to be breached at some point. It depends how damaging it is or how deep people get in the network. So they need to be able to go to the board when it happens and say, we took the right steps to at least mitigate that risk. And I don't think if cybersecurity specialists, you know, the ones that do make that change, talking about cybersecurity, they're talking about risk, the ones that do, they'll be way ahead of the game. But as far as the silo mentality, I mean, cybersecurity cuts across all departments of any company, right from the receptionist to the IT guy, to the CEO. You know, most breaches aren't malicious. They are some employee that clicked on the wrong thing.
Right.
And that could start at the receptionist. So the silo mentality that cybersecurity is a data issue or an IT issue or any the customer service issue has to go away. I mean, you have to train everybody as part of an onboarding process, the receptionist, the new customer service rep, the new C-level executive, cybersecurity awareness.
It's tough because, like, how do you train your IT department to, because it's going to fall on the IT department expectedly. This is how, you know, that silo mentality has gone, is that, you know, okay, well, we're, this is the IT department's responsibility to educate the staff, but not every IT person is a teacher or, you know, is able to take that information, that knowledge, and translate it down to a different level that is not IT centric.
Right. And I think that's where that, you know, breaking down the silo mentality really has to take place. The IT department in this case has to work with probably either the HR department or a learning and development department to take the technology buzzwords out of the equation, right? Mm-hmm. There's a big talk about gamification right now, right? Mm-hmm. So you can give somebody a PowerPoint, very dry, talk about all the technology, how to be cybersecurity aware, and it's just not going to have any impact. But if you could, I don't say dumb it down, but if you could make it more fun and take out the buzzwords and make it more relatable, because again, most of these things aren't people, cyber criminals attacking a network and having the technology to breach it. It's attacking an individual on a human level and having them click on the wrong things. If you can take your cybersecurity training and humanize it or gamify it, you're going to have much better results. So the IT department's got to work with, again, HR and probably the learning and management teams.
Yeah, it's making me think of just recently I heard of a customer who was in the accounting department and had received an invoice, and that invoice was, lo and behold, ransomware and infiltrated their network. Now, luckily they had good backups and that was the situation they were able to recover, but it could be that simple that the accountant receives an invoice and opens it.
I mean, I've worked in this industry a long time, and I've actually sat in rooms where the company has done a phishing test.
Yeah.
And 10 individuals in the room all working in cybersecurity, and you can guarantee 3 of them are going to click on it. It's
wow.
Just the nature of the beast, right?
Yeah.
You know, you get an email that says, hey, there's a problem with your expenses. You panic. Mm-hmm. You just don't realize that there's no signature attached. That's how easy it is.
Yeah. And statistically, as you say, like if 3 in 10 cybersecurity-minded people, because there's a reason that these kinds of threats have been labeled as social engineering, because
Absolutely.
these are folks who understand in a lot of cases, who understand the mentalities and the, you know, how to create a reactionary a reaction from the recipient, and if only 3 in 10 people fall for it. Well, that's 30% that they've been able to infiltrate, presumably.
And that's the challenge of cybersecurity in general. You know, as cybersecurity specialists, we have to be right 100% of the time.
Yeah.
Even if the cybersecurity criminals are right 1% of the time, they still win.
Sure. So you mentioned, you know, working with the IT department and HR and educating in a fun way. Are there resources, Jim, that we can tie into or tap into to be able to arm the IT department with the necessary, like whether it be PowerPoints or, you know, ideas or thought starters? What can we do?
Yeah, I mean, I'll just mention that ESET has an online free training that we offer. It's kind of cybersecurity 101. There is a certificate at the end.
Great.
So obviously we'd like to promote that. We think everybody should take it, but there's, if you just search LinkedIn, if you actually go to your trusted advisors, you just need to come up with something.
Okay.
That cybersecurity training 101 needs to be part of the onboarding program for every single new employee.
Good advice. I'm going to put a link for that in the notes below. So if you're watching this online, make sure you check that out. It's a free resource from ESET, and we're going to provide that to you and your staff. Jim, I mentioned the Marriott breach, but from your perspective, both personally and with your work at ESET, are there any other standouts as far as cybersecurity attacks that match or even exceed that magnitude?
So I mentioned it before, and I don't think when we study cybersecurity down the road, I don't think you can avoid not talking about the Ashley Madison breach. I think that's probably the most significant breach in the last 10 years. You know, whether you agree or disagree with the morality or ethics of that business, right? That was a privately held company that had 25 gigabits of data stolen and pushed out on the internet. And it devastated that company. Again, somewhere in the ethical argument, that piece got lost. And the other piece that happened is it had truly personal impact on individuals. Again, the ethical morality piece has to be put aside. There was individuals that committed suicide because their information was put on the internet. And, you know, forget the personal level, on a business level, you know, a lot of people kind of thought that company got what they deserved because of what they were doing.
Sure.
It was still a criminal act, and it raised the question of hacktivism, which I don't think really a lot of people talked about very much, right? Mm-hmm. Was that an ethical hack? You know, recently, you know, we'll talk about current links in the news. There's a lot of people talking about the Mueller report in the U.S. and whether somebody should hack the Justice Department and get that so the public can see it. Mm-hmm. Is that hacktivism or is it a criminal act? And I think Ashley Madison's a perfect example of how those two things got mixed together and confused. Whether, regardless of what the company does, if it's they're breached and personal data stolen, it's a criminal act. And I think we'll study Ashley Madison for years because it created, you know, this hacktivism mentality. You know, is it a good hack? You know, did it have personal implications on people? Mm-hmm. That's when I think it's going to go down in history.
Yeah, no, absolutely makes sense. I haven't really given it much thought, but to think that, you know, our mentality as individuals who are not involved in that hack is like,
right.
Oh, well, they, like you say, they got what was coming to them. But to break it down to the individuals who were affected by that and the company itself, it's like, where is that line in cybersecurity?
You know, the next obvious step is, and we've actually seen these kind of threats out there. You know, you hack Ashley Madison, and then you're that group of hacktivists are upset with the bank that cleared the credit cards for Ashley Madison.
Right.
So
where does it
is
end?
It ethically correct for them to go and then hack the bank and steal information and damage their integrity, even though they were really, you know, they weren't necessarily doing unethical. So, again, I think that's it really pushes the boundary of good, you know, white hats, black hats, hacktivism, criminality.
Jim, thanks so much. It's been a pleasure having you on the endpointsecurity.ca podcast.
Thank you, Rob. It was a pleasure talking to you.
To ensure day-to-day procedures support cybersecurity, executives and IT professionals alike need to widen the cybersecurity conversation beyond technology. Many breaches and hacks are the result of human weakness, such as clicking on a link in a phishing email or not maintaining adequate password hygiene, or even not removing apps or contractor access permissions from a database or network once they're no longer needed. Most of these types of errors happen because of a time crunch. People are busy, overloaded with meetings and messages, and have consequently lost the ability or opportunity for critical thinking and diligent action. Mistakes are made in haste, and the repercussions can literally cost a company its life. This means that executives and IT professionals together must look at the overarching culture of their organization to ensure soft skills such as time management and relationship management are taught, reinforced, and rewarded. A culture that does not allow time for employees to prioritize will endure the repercussions of malware. A culture that does not allow time for data backups will fall prey to ransomware. A culture that keeps employees perpetually on a hamster wheel opens itself up to attack from more focused predators. These are management issues, but they deserve attention from the C-suite and the IT department when the two meet face-to-face as regularly as possible across the adults' table. Here at endpointsecurity.ca, we're obviously very concerned with the safety and security of our customers, their businesses, and their data. But as our chat here shows, the concern can't end there. We have a blog that follows up from this conversation. You can find it at blog.endpointsecurity.ca. And as you know, our close relationship with the experts at ESET means that we here at Positive eSolutions have your back. So thank you again to Jim for joining me today, and thanks to you for joining us as well. Stay safe out there, and be sure to join me again for the next chapter in our ongoing series on cybersecurity for Canadian business. From Positive eSolutions, I'm Robbie Ferguson.